Now, I would like to invite Ms. Tan King to give her speech on the Malaysian open source software deployment strategies and practices. Tan King currently serves as the open source consultant in the Apiris group of companies.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for having me here today. It's really an honor for me to share Malaysian experience in open source with you. Thank you. Okay, I'm now OSS consultant, but I was formerly the head of OSCC, Open Source Competency Center in Malaysia. And today, the title of my talk will be the Malaysian OSS Deployment Strategies and Practices. In the public sector, OSS industry, OSS community, followed by challenges and future direction. The Malaysian Public Sector OSS Initiative. Michael Timmen, former president of the OSI, has called it a Malaysian success story. And he said that the progress that Malaysia has made with open source has caught the attention of governments of developed and emerging economies. So Gartner too, in a case study, said that Malaysia shows what being strategic on open source means. And yes, even United Nations noticed us, and the inspection unit came to visit and had nice things to talk about us. And also Malaysia was elected chairperson of UNESCO expert group meeting. So the Open Source Competency Center had lots of official visits from governments of developing and developed countries, and we were also invited to talks to share our experience. And the local business community were also paying tribute to the government initiative and said that Malaysia is demonstrating outstanding leadership and accomplishment in public sector OSS implementation. Even the local media were having news on open source implementation in the public sector, and I guess all this international recognition as well as local news has created a lot of hype and excitement that makes this following NGOs to support and also promote the Malaysian public sector OSS initiative. Important ICT organizations such as MDEC, which is responsible for implementing the Malaysian Silicon Valley, they too provide funds and support to set up OSS startups, provide incubators and test beds to do R&D. PICOM is the National Association of Malaysia. They will, more than 95% of the ICT companies were their members, and they were also on the OSS bandwagon. Now, most importantly, the other three huge organizations like Consumers Association, they were promoting open source passionately to safeguard their consumers, the ordinary consumers. And they were requesting us to help lobby for OEM to debundle proprietary software from PC to safeguard consumers from paying unnecessary or software that they do not need and lock them in. Okay, proprietary software, that's it. The other two organizations are huge organizations with hundreds of thousands of companies. There are SMEs like Chambers of Commerce and manufacturing industries. These SMEs are in dire need of ICT to run their competitions, to run their companies' business, but they could not afford the proprietary software. So they too come to Mampu and ask us to help them to educate their members. So with all the support from these important ICT companies and huge organizations like Federation of Manufacturers, Chambers of Commerce, it looks like the entire nation was involved in implementing the government OSS initiative. We also received awards, etc. But I think the truth is in the figures. So as of 2012, 99.3% of all the public agencies, government agencies, were using open source software in some way or another. And this results in 370 million ringgit in cost savings. And we believe that, we know that this is just the tip of the iceberg because there are many other unreported cases. So in short, the government OSS initiative has resulted in benefits, definitely more cost-effective and more connected government, increased growth in local ICT industry, enhanced human capital development, increased knowledge-based society, and so on. But most importantly, it has spawned a new OSS industry and a new OSS community that helps to create a knowledge-based society. And these together form the pillars of national transformation, which help us to towards realizing Vision 2020. Now, how does it all started, this government OSS initiative? So it started in 2002. Actually, I have lots of stories to tell, but I have to finish this within half an hour, so I'm just going through very fast. I was fortunate to be given a task of doing the cabinet paper, presenting the study results as well as recommendations for this initiative, and also to apply for funds. And needless to say, the funds was approved, and like they said, the rest was history. So in 2004, 2002, cabinet safe study, 2004, the government declare it's open source from now on with a two-pronged strategy, building, formulating master plan and as well as a competency center, OSS competency center, we call OSCC. And this is a two-pronged strategy because either one of these without the other would not have worked, because Malaysia at that time do not have the OSS skills. And just having the plan alone without the competency to give us the training, to build the enabling environment, we would not have been able to do it, because we were also deep and locked in by the proprietary software. So the vision was simple. It was to use, to create and enhance value by using open source to bring about a more cost-effective and quality public service, with the objectives of reducing total cost of ownership, and also very importantly, we want to control our own destiny. We want to increase freedom of choice of software, increase interoperability, increase growth of local ICT industry, and so on. And under the guiding principles of coexistence with other legacy proprietary systems, and also implementation must be fit for purpose. So we adopt a phased approach, that is, beginning from laying the foundation where enabling environment was put in place. Enabling environment that consists of governance, infrastructure, and very important, the pilot projects, because pilot projects demonstrate and showcase proof that open source works and saves us valuable money. Okay, and this is followed by accelerated adoption, where OSS is proliferated throughout the public agencies, throughout the public sector. And the end game is self-reliance, where the governments would finally be able to be self-reliant, have in sovereignty in technology, sovereignty choice of software, that we are totally in control of our own destiny. develop our own technology rather than just consumers of foreign technology that just makes our foreign exchange flow out of the country. Okay. So master plan includes framework where all the components are put in place. All the components that are necessary for the realization of the OSS objectives, such as solution areas, enabling environment, together at the core of it, the knowledge bank, they must be there in the framework. Okay? And very important are the strategic thrusts. There are 7 strategic thrusts. Each of these strategic thrusts have owners from relevant government agencies. And for example, like Strategic Trust 2 entrusts a governing body to champion and monitor and drive OSS implementation. MANPU, which is something like an IT authority, was appointed to be the governing body. So this is in line. This is the relevant agency. For example, like Strategic Trust 3, train and develop human resources. Ministry of Education was appointed to be owner of this strategic trust and to implement this trust, to see that the hard targets, all this trust has got hard targets, are being fulfilled, are being delivered, and to come out with to churn out a new breed, new generation of OSS competent students and young professionals from universities. Likewise, legal direction is under the charge of Attorney General's office. So relevant agencies are responsible to deliver the strategic trust targets. Now, there's also a very close monitoring mechanism where MANPU, as the governing body, chairs the OSS steering committee and reports to the cabinet. And there are members of the committee are owners of all the strategic trusts, including representatives from industry, from community, and the academia, the universities. Okay. So that was the master plan. The second part of the two-pronged strategy was the Open Source Competency Center. So the main objective is to lead, guide, and assist government agencies to develop and implement open source, with OSS giving out functions, providing training, technical support, maintenance, R&D, and so on. The second pivotal role of the center, the OSCC, is playing the role of a physical and virtual bridge that gets the three communities together in close exchange of research findings, ideas, etc., and also in very close collaborative engagements for successful delivery of OSS services and solutions. And this is very important. These three communities, like public sector, represents a major OSS consumer where it generates OSS demands. R&D community, mainly the research institutes and universities, which does research that is geared for the use of government, which satisfies the government's requirements. And also the business community are the ICT industry, which collaborates to help commercialize these research fundings and together provide services and solutions to serve the government. Okay, so that we together control our own destiny, create our own employment, create our own industry, our own jobs to satisfy our needs. Okay, so OSCC governance includes guidelines, standards, etc. OSS implementation guidelines, we have guidelines that cover the implementation of all strategic thrusts. And my GFORS, it is very important that we promote open standards. It publish minimal standards that need to be complied by all agencies to ensure information access and interoperability. Because in the past, proprietary systems has made agencies not able to talk to each other. Okay. Now, very important also is the OSCC also developed open source products developed once but used by any agencies in the public sector with OSCC services such as Help Desk, Knowledge Bank, e-marketplace, OSS Development Toolkit to make it easy for them to develop and implement open source. Now, in the past, agencies were just procuring proprietary software applications on their own. This could be all similar applications, and it was duplicated many times, and they are locked in. But with this, the government really saves a lot of money because avoids the duplication. And the center just built once, but to be used by all agencies. And in future, if any agency wants to develop any application, all they have to do is refer to this repository of OSS applications. They can just take it and customize it for their own needs. Okay. So in short, the public sector OSS initiative does come up, has given us a lot of achievements, and the achievements actually transcend beyond the public sector and provide a positive impact, great impact on human capital development, and also spawning a new OSS industry. Why do we succeed? This is what we think. We think that there is a holistic approach. All things considered, all relevant stakeholders are involved from the beginning. And also, there is a phased approach from pilots to rollouts and from foundation to accelerated adoption and so on. Also, very important are the two-pronged strategy building. You can't just have a plan without the center, it won't work, because we are too deeply ingrained in proprietary and we don't have the necessary skills. Now, building trust is important, and pilot projects, monitoring, governance, all these are important for building trust to convince the government agencies, to convince the public sector, and to win commitments. Okay, another important thing is the entire nation is networked to communicate and collaborate on this OSS vision and our initiative. And very important also is the OSCC acts as a center to build and nourish this OSS ecosystem. There is an e-marketplace at the center. The e-marketplace creates and continuously increase the OSS demands and supplies, and it is in the e-marketplace that the three communities get together and meet each other's requirements. Okay, passion, creating excitement and passion and momentum to mobilize people to action. This is very important. So what about the Malaysian industry? Now, before the OSS initiative, the entire OSS industry is dominated by proprietary giants, IBM, Microsoft, and we use foreign technology at high cost, and we got locked in. After the initiative, 53% of local ICT vendors are OSS SMEs. Now there's a chance for our own people, SMEs, to do business in open source. There are many reasons, because there is low entry to OSS market. And just in our e-marketplace, there are 71 vendors in OSCC. This, in the words of the CEO of MDEC, about the impact of OSS initiative on ICT industry. 39 MSC Malaysian companies in the OSS industry generated $595 million in local revenues and over $234 million in export revenues, employing 6,000 over ICT knowledge workers. This is unprecedented. Before OSS, as I told you, there was no OSS service provider. There wasn't one. You know, there's no such thing as OSS service provider. So the OSS industry was non-existent, but after open source initiative, and this is from the words of others, not from us. It's a different, and that is the impact. It is hard, but it does help to spawn a new industry, OSS industry, that stimulates and increase the growth of the local economy. Okay, so in the Malaysian OSS industry, what are their OSS deployment strategy? That's my topic. Just like anywhere else in the world, Malaysian vendors employ a combination of all these four strategies, which is building OSS, yeah, building infrastructure, middleware, applications for direct returns, yeah. Secondly, building with OSS, where you use OSS framework to build applications for licensing, you know. And thirdly, building for OSS, where our vendors supply OSS distributions with professional services, providing professional services like training, technical support, consultation, you know, all those things. And also building on OSS, meaning using open source to run their organizations, you know, building their organizations on OSS. So Malaysian companies use a combination of all this. I'm sure it's the same for the rest. And business practices in Malaysia. Our vendors could supply open source software using community license, or they could customize this OSS to clients' requirements and have a customized licensing. Or we could build our own software, like Jogget is a Malaysian built software, where dual licensing is practiced. You know, the enterprise license has got more features. And also, another way of dual licensing is building proprietary extension on OpenCore. This can be done. Very common in Malaysian vendors, with Malaysian vendors, are producing supplying software as a service, okay? And this is very good for our SMEs, because 70% of our GDP comes from SMEs. So when we are able to do this, our SMEs can use open source software, which is cheaper and more affordable. Okay, these are the nature of business. Includes IT modernization, where vendors use open source for cost efficiency, carbon efficiency, cloud computing, software development, mobility, big data, Internet of Things. And as I said before, professional services include consultation, technical support, you know, maybe network services, infrastructure installation, etc. And both enterprise-wide as well as community version software are supplied. For enterprise version, our vendors may usually collaborate with the principals to provide you with SLA commitments, bundled warranty, bundled maintenance and support. And for community version, our vendors also collaborate with our community to take advantage of the development and maintenance resource. And in return, the company will provide funds or sponsorship for the community events. So now, both the free software and the fees-based software are both enterprise ready. And usually there's a mix and match, depending on the needs, mix and match, depending on the needs of the client's budget and requirements. Sometimes community version is good enough. Okay, some other examples of the business in Malaysia, OSS business migration. It has been documented, 70% cost savings, yeah? Linux, Unix to Linux, middleware migration, 85% cost savings. A lot of it comes from savings of high software costs as well as high hardware maintenance costs. Okay, virtualization is also very popular, where in this case, the Malacca state, 70 servers were replaced with just 14 servers and two storage. And of course, a lot of savings and the accompanying complexities is avoided. Big data, I come from Abires, a company is a leading pioneer open source company in Malaysia, and they have successfully delivered public sector open source big data project to the government, and also a few other ministerial level big data projects. Now, this public sector big data projects has got four use cases on sentiment analysis, price watch, disease control, and crime prevention. And this afternoon at 1:15, there's going to be a workshop. So to know more, please just attend that workshop. Okay, training, of course, is also a popular service. Now, what I want to tell you is that now there is, our economy has become more service-based, service-intensive. If before we were just doing trading, middlemen, but now this is creating value, enhancing value, and more service-intensive. Thank you. Okay, now the Malaysian OSS community. The community, there are many OSS communities, they are all unified under one umbrella organization called MOSMY, M-O-S-C-M-Y, with a vision to promote open source development to become world-class OSS community. There are more than 50 OSS communities, and even the communities self-govern, they have their own master plan, started in 2010 and achieved in 2015. Where objectives was met, and there are now more than 50 local-led projects, 1,000 over OSS core developers. Okay, there are major areas and community activities are in research and development. Of course, they joined international projects, building community. Assisting in an open source conference and giving free tuition for W3C schools. And they are also involved in OSS business for our local SMEs, okay? Because more affordable, university collaboration and so on. Now these are just examples of their activities. They also have their own FOSS conference. And now, what are the challenges and future direction? Phase one and two, after every phase, we have a benefit realization analysis and report. They have been all targets met. The last phase, the self-reliance, okay, it is still in progress. Although half of all the ministries are now self-certified self-reliant, but we still cannot be considered as technology developers and an OSS hub, even though we have a thriving OSS industry that produce some exports. Now, so the future direction is, if in the past the emphasis was on OSS cost savings, being free from being locked in, now the emphasis is on instituting OSS culture of innovation. I think we miss out a little bit on the OSS process. Our government programmers and system analysts were not as good as we want them to be. We want them to be not only self-independent and very competent OSS developers, being self-sufficient, but we also want them to be contributing to international projects, you know, and make OSS, make Malaysia a hub of OSS. So the direction now is from OSSC, we want to go towards OSDET, Open Source Development and Capability Center. So the focus is on development, okay? How to be an OSS hub, how to be more, contribute to the international projects as well. And oh, there's something, the things that are hidden is that in our public sector ICT strategic plan from 2016 to 2020, the government has declared open source to be the first choice, preferred choice, okay? And so the future direction is this, cultivating OSS culture of innovation. We want the OSDET to host all public sector OSS projects although this was done before, but didn't, so we are retrying this again, you know, with our own version of GitHub, SourceForge.net, and so on. And we hope that Malaysia becomes technology developer and technology hub. So, indeed, we think that the two-prong strategy has contributed to a more connected government, a more productive OSS industry, and a vibrant community. And the little that we put in to set up the center, we consider it as a very small investment that brings us multiple, that rewards us hundreds of folds over and over in terms of human capital development, in terms of our open door, government open door facility, in terms of a more integrated public service. Agencies, systems can talk to each other. Okay, in terms of a new OSS industry that is spawned, and a new stimulation to stimulating our local economic growth, and so on. So we think it is worth it. Thank you.